So hey guys, I want to ask you one thing, because this worked out really well at Winter Retreat. If you could just put your phones in your pockets, I know if you use them as a Bible, that's fine. If you need a Bible, we'll get you a Bible. You should be bringing a Bible to church anyways. Put your phones, your iPads, your devices, stick them in your pockets, because you know what? The Lord works a lot better, I've seen, especially with this weekend, for you guys actually being consumed in His Word. Because unfortunately, sometimes, even though you might start out with your Bible on your phone, the unfortunate thing is you end up on Facebook. Or taking a selfie and then posting it while I'm preaching, and then I see it later. Okay? So, for my sake and for respect of the Lord's Word, I would encourage you guys to just put your phones away. Just stick them in your pocket. Your mommy will be okay for the next 15 minutes. Trust me, she will be fine. It will be okay. And I would appreciate that. All right? I love you guys. I think you're amazing. But one thing God has taught me over this weekend is that His Word is sovereign. And it is the most important thing that will ever exist in our lives. And that is one thing in our household that's ringing true. And is we take it a lot more seriously because it's a true story. Man, tonight's message. Listen, I over the weekend, believe it or not, over the weekend, I was thinking about this message. What are we going to preach on the first Wednesday when we get back? You know, it's an amazing thing when the Spirit of the Lord works, because He really... just throws things at you. I mean, I'm making a video at 2 o'clock in the morning, and all of a sudden out of nowhere, He's like, "Oh, this is what I want you to be preaching on right here." Bam! And He hits me with it, and I just like freeze. I'm like, all right, God, this is what you want. I had to write it down. Okay, this is what we need to do. You know, because this, you guys cold? Some of you look like you're shivering. You okay? Everybody's all right? We're good? All right. So in a second, we'll be doing jumping jacks, because that's a part of this sermon. No. Just kidding. Games are over. But listen to this. So I wanted to preach a message, listen, that sets the stone and the pace for the rest of this year. Because this is our first youth group message. This is our first youth group of the year. And you know what? What an amazing thing it is. Amen. That's right. All I can say about 2014 is this. This youth ministry is going to change this world. All right? Because I saw many of you this weekend. And if you didn't come this weekend, again, I'll say I'm very sorry you weren't there. This message is important for you. And even though I'm talking about the weekend and you feel terrible because you didn't go, we're still thinking of you, all right? And we wish you would have been with us. So as I'm going through this, just be reminded of that. But as I was saying, this weekend we saw, listen, I saw the Spirit, I saw God, I saw Him just move through you guys. It was all the way from sixth graders to seniors who were going to be graduating in about 4 or 5 months. And it was a beautiful thing. There were people who accepted the Lord, who committed their lives to God, that I thought, as a pastor, I thought I was good on. I didn't have to worry about. But you know what God showed me? That it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what you... How you... Whoa, Jesus. Lord have mercy. I don't know. I might need to let music stay for that. That was crazy. Satan, leave! No. Just kidding. I need another stand. That's going to happen again. Man.
Hey, you did put your device away.
That's right. I don't have to put my device away. You know why? Because I have to read from it. I'm not playing on Facebook. Now, if y'all saw me going like this, then y'all need to be worried about it, right? I feel bad for my kids. One day, never mind. I got to stay on focus. Anyways, it was amazing to see God just move. And there were people I thought were okay. I thought, you know what? They've got Jesus. I don't have to worry about it. Let's focus on... But you know what? He totally wiped me away. He totally said, whoa, dude, you've got it wrong. Your responsibility is to just preach and teach to anybody and everybody as much as you can. And it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter who it is. It doesn't matter where they grew up. It doesn't matter what. I don't care if they grew up in a Christian home and their mommy and daddy were pastors. It doesn't matter. Because they might not know Jesus. And that really hit me this weekend. So that's the stage that we're going to set for the rest of this year. So tonight's message is called Becoming a New Creation. I don't got a logo. I got nothing. I want no distractions tonight. It's called Becoming a New Creation. And my little parenthesis is this. Who do you live for now? Who do you live for now? And that's the stage that I want to set for the rest of the years. Who do you live for now? For some of you, you live for a lot of crazy things before this weekend. Whether it was relationships or school or parents. Maybe your parents lived through you. Maybe it was a bad experience that you were living in and you were worshiping the guilt from that experience. because you couldn't get away from it? Maybe it was heartache. And what were you living for? What were you living for at the time? Many of you have changed who you were living for. Many of you are now living for God. Many of you are chasing after God. Many of you are. One of the most beautiful things I heard is one of our students was kind of talking about the fact that they want to become a nicer person. They don't want to pick on people. They don't want to make fun of people. They want to become a nicer person. And to hear that struggle and them talk about how they have friends who still are being that way, and it's hard to be mixed in with that, to see that, to see how they want to be better and how they're around those friends, and it's tough to become better or to make yourself better or to grow better. But the coolest thing about it is to know that that's God that's doing that. Because God shows us and He teaches us that if we try ourselves, we'll fail. But through His power, we can succeed. And to just hear those type of things. Listen, that's an exciting thing to hear students say, I'm struggling with trying to keep on my faith. You know why? Because that means they're trying to keep on their faith. That means they're trying to make that happen. That's a really exciting thing. Again, this weekend, amazing weekend. It was awesome. It was great to just see how God moved. To see so many students just on their knees crying, worshiping, giving over life to God. Realizing that, listen, I'm a failure. I need your help to heal my heart in an area. I struggle with this, and to give that to Him was just an amazing thing. So whether you've been a believer for years, you just became a believer this year, literally, this weekend, one of the most important things is once becoming a believer, what does that mean? What does it mean to be a believer? You know, when I turned 13 years old, I accepted Christ. I went on to this camp. It was up in Tennessee, North Carolina, somewhere like that. I was like 13 years old. And I remember the preacher getting up, the guy was sharing about Jesus and how we're all sinners and how we need Jesus and how I'm gonna go to hell and be separated from God if I don't have Jesus. And you know, it might have been an emotional thing, but you know what? I felt the power of the Lord in me. I said, man, I need this. I'm a failure. There's no way that I'm ever gonna be good unless God is in me and I need Him. So I went up to the altar. I laid down. I bawled like a little baby. You know, I did everything that you should do, and that happens when you accept the Lord, and I did that. But you know what? After that, nobody ever told me what it was, what I was. Nobody told me what I was. They just said, oh, you're saved, you're saved. Oh, hallelujah, you got Jesus. You're not going to hell. You get a free, get out of hell free card, man. You're good to go. But nobody told me what it really was or what I really did. They just said, you accepted Christ. Little did I know that just accepting Christ, I was reborn. Well, we'll talk about this. I was reborn. I was now adopted into a family that was huge. And my father was unbelievable. Spiritual father was unbelievable. I am now royalty. I didn't know that. Nobody shared that with me. And so for years, I just thought I was saved and safe. I thought I was good to go. I thought, hey, what the heck? I'll do whatever I want. I'm going to go to heaven, so what's it matter? And that's what I thought. And that's true. I am saved, and I am going to go to heaven. But we shouldn't just think that we can go do whatever we want to do. And that's where many, many young believers, and I was very young, 13 years old, many young believers, that's what happens. We accept Christ. We understand the salvation, and we've accepted Him. But then we're not told anymore after that. We don't know anymore after that. And because of that, we decide to, or because of life, we fall back into the world and we become a part of the world. We're still saved. We're still going to heaven. But we're missing out on a lot. Missing out on a lot that God has given us and can give us because we're not under His blessing, because we're not being a part of His faithful kingdom. So that's what we're talking about. Romans 1:16 says this, "For I am not ashamed of this good news about Christ. It is the power of God at work, saving everyone who believes, the Jews first and also the Gentiles." Romans 1:16. Listen, the power of God, the salvation of Jesus Christ, is something you should not be ashamed of. We did a whole series on that. It is something you should not be ashamed of. Don't be ashamed that you're a Christian. You tell everybody. The worst thing that they can do, mock you. If we were in another country, the worst thing to do is probably kill you. And some of you laugh about that and you say, well, death is the worst thing that could happen. Now, let me tell you something that's worse than death. It's spending eternity separated from God. Okay? That's worse than just death itself. Don't be ashamed of the gospel. Don't be ashamed that you are a Christian. You have a free gift. Kirk talked about that. You got a free gift that you can share. Don't hold it to yourself. Don't be ashamed of that gift. Share it. Give it. You know, people want to change. We all want to change. I, about a month, 2 months ago, went on this diet that, you know what, I finally came to the, said, you know what, in a couple years, my wife and I are going to probably want to start having kids. You know, I want to be a fit father. My dad was fit. Okay, he was fit when we were born. And I want to be like that. I want to be in good health. I want to be fit. It's going to take a lot to have kids. It's going to take a lot to have kids and then still run around with you guys. So I want to be in good shape, you know? So Melanie and I, we came together, we prayed about it. We said, this is what we're going to do. This is how we're going to make this happen. And we started that course. We started that challenge. And it's been a great thing. It's been really tough, but it's something that we've had to do. Everybody wants to change. There's something about you that you want to change. We all want to change. Whether we want to change our heart because it's broken, our face because we think it's ugly, our feet because one toe is like really fat and all the other ones. You know what I mean? Like there's always something. Nobody else got that problem? No? Okay. There's something we all want to change. You know, advertising is based on the perception that people want things different from the way they are. Every time you see a commercial, man, every time you see a commercial, they want, you have to be better. You got to be better. You know, I don't care if it's a kite commercial. Their kite's better than your kite. You know what I mean? Like, it's sick, okay? It's sick. From Mary Poppins, man.
Why are you thinking about
Mary? I just watched Mary Poppins.
Why?
I've never seen it before, ever. I was 25 years old, the first time I ever saw it. And we just went and saw Saving Mr. Banks. Anyways, that's off topic. So commercials, man, they fly their kite, it's better than yours. Before you know it, you gotta spend $9.99, then you'll get two. All right, infomercials, you have no idea. None of you guys watch any commercials anymore. We want change. Advertisement teaches us that we want change. We want to look better, feel better, think better, live better. They want change in their lives, except for the external standpoint. They are unable to do so. Listen, I can work out. I can go on a diet. I can make my outer body look unbelievable. Okay? I can. Man, I could be ripping it like crazy. But let me tell you something. No matter how good my outer looks, without Jesus, my inner is crap. Perfect example. My dad, we have a family doctor. His name is Dr. Patel. 55 years old. This guy's a doctor, all right? Family doctor, good health, good man. Loved his family, loved his kids. Died this past week, 55 years old, massive heart attack. You know one thing that teaches me out of that is this. When God wants you to go home, he's going to take you home. It doesn't matter. You don't have some threat or lifespan that you're guaranteed and you're going to be okay. When God wants to take you home, he's going to take you home. So no matter how much we on our outsides try to look the absolute best, if our inside is crap, wretched, broken, hurting, decaying, we can't change that. How many of you ever tried to change a broken heart? All you do is eat ice cream, watch baby movies, you know what I mean? Like that's it, that's what makes you happy. I was trying to say like girly movies, but I said baby movies. You know, girly movies, man. Oh my God, 101 Dalmatians. You know, I'm just kidding. Listen, only the gospel of Jesus Christ has the power to change people, to deliver them from sin, from Satan, from judgment, from death, and from hell. We can try to change our outer works, and we can do that. You know, we have a gym. We go to a gym called Hardcore Fitness. All right, there's guys in there. Man, their necks are like that big around. Those guys are beasts. All right? I mean, beasts. You know? But that's too big. That's right. Give me a hug. You know what I mean? Like, it's just like, whoa, you know? But you know what? But you know what? You know why they look like that? Probably because they're spending all their time in the gym. You want, the guests wonder why they're spending all their time in their gym? Because they're probably lonely. And they're probably trying to fill their lives with something. And you know what? They go to the gym, they spend hours. I mean, some guys there, it's like, I leave the gym after my 45 minutes of gym. That's it. I leave, I come back the next day, and they're still right there. You know what I mean? I'm thinking, dude, did you go home? Is the gym closed? You know what I mean? No. These guys, listen, they're trying their best to fill a void that they have. They're trying their best to fill the void.
How could I do that without, like, passing out?
Oh, I don't know. They probably go home and sleep for a couple hours and then come back. Those guys got to be out of breath, man. That's good, dude. It's high five. No, I love it. It makes us laugh. It's good. You know, we want that. Many of us experience the presence of God this week. And many of us experience, I love it when the parents laugh. It makes my night. I told a good joke. No.
No, they did.
Many of us experienced the presence of the Lord this weekend. We did. You know, some of you might be denying it right now, but no, I don't know. My belly was upset, you know. The food was terrible. You know what I mean? That's a true story, though. Eggs were good. Sausage, I'm not sure what that was. But I had a lot of it, but I don't know what it was. But you know what? We felt the presence of the Lord. We experienced it. Acts 4:12 says, there is salvation in no one else. God has given no other name under heaven by which we must be saved. And that name is Jesus Christ. Listen, no one else can save you. No person can save you. They can save, somebody can save your life, your physical life, you know, pull you off the edge or you know, grab the steering wheel when you're texting and driving, you shouldn't be. CPR. You know, somebody can physically save your life. But there is salvation in no one else but Jesus Christ. So we see this, we understand this. So God's word, which is all about Jesus Christ, can do for us what we cannot do for ourselves. Those guys in the gym pumping iron for hours on hours and hours, probably trying to fill a void that's in their heart. Maybe it's their job. Maybe not. Maybe we're thinking it a little too critically. Maybe that's their job. They go to those, you know, bodylifting, whatever they're called. And, you know, I don't know. What's it called?
Bodybuilding.
There we go. Bodybuilding. I don't know. Maybe it's their job. Maybe it's not. Maybe they were married at one time. Their wife died. Their wife left them. Their kids died. We don't know. We don't know what's going on with them, but we know that just because they're there lifting those weights and he's making himself on the outside look big and better, that his inside can be broken. And that's the same thing that's happening to us and that can happen to us. Open up your Bibles to 2 Corinthians 5. We're going to be in verses 12 through 21. We're going to be picking out some of those verses tonight. We're going to be talking about becoming a believer. What is it to be a Christian? Like, what? I wasn't a Christian. I accepted Christ. I rededicated my life to him. I gave myself to Christ. What now? Like, what does that mean? And that's what we're going to talk about tonight. What does that mean? And I want to tell you a little story because, like I said, when I was 13, I accepted Christ. I kind of went to church on and off a little bit. My parents kind of forced me to go to church. I wasn't crazy involved with it until I started going to First Baptist. Then I was a lot more involved with it there. I was probably more like 15 then, 14, 15. No, I think I was more like 15 years old then. It wasn't until I was like 16 and a half that I came across this text. And it wasn't until then that I realized, man, I've been missing something here. I've been missing something here. What have I been doing for the last 3-4 years? Like, I know that I accepted Christ and I know that I was saved. But I've been missing something. And it wasn't because somebody taught it to me. It wasn't because somebody shared it with me. It's because I just was sitting down one day and doing my own devotions. And, you know, JJ challenged us in the youth group and said, hey, I really want some of you guys to do personal devotions. And we're all kind of like, what's that? You know, I mean, I got a Bible. It's in my pocket, you know. We just had no idea what that was. So you challenge, just open God's Word and read it. And in 2 Corinthians is where I opened. I started reading through that. And it was amazing to read through that and to see that. And then I came across this text, and it really changed the outlook I had on life. You know, because then I realized, wow, like I became a believer, but there was so much more than just being saved. Like I'm part of a family. I now have a responsibility as a believer. And for many of us, we're like, whoa, responsibilities, that's crazy. But like, it's a beautiful responsibility. It's a nice responsibility to have as a believer. And you always wonder why we talk about don't live for Christ just in church, live for Christ outside of the church. And we'll get to that. I don't want to give you too much. So a little bit of history of this text. Paul wrote this on his second missionary journey. Paul was a great pastor in the first century church. He had a couple missionary trips. He wrote this on his second missionary trip. The reason that he wrote this, he saw immorality that was taking place within this church, the Corinth church. The first part of chapter 5 is about receiving new bodies when we get to heaven. You know, what an interesting thing as a new believer. Well, I wasn't a new believer then. I guess I've been a believer for a couple years, but never really studied scripture, so I still kind of consider myself and my faith as new in my faith. Maybe not a new believer. But you come in chapter 5 and you open it up, and Paul's talking about like these new bodies and stuff, and there's portions in the scripture where he talks about like, when we get to heaven, we're not just going to be like floating spirits, you know? Many of us have envisioned that we're going to get like wings and be angels. No, we're above the angels, you know? Many of us believe that we're going to get to heaven and just be like, ha, la, 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 you know what I mean, float around. No, that's not what's going to happen. Listen, when God created Adam and Eve, what did he create them to do? To worship him and to do what? What was Ab's job? What was Adam's job when he was in the garden? Name the gardens, name the animals. To cultivate the garden.
Oh,
to work.
To work.
To work. Yeah, to work.
Really?
Yeah, to work. When God created us, he created us to worship and to work. All right? We have good muscles. All right? We're fit. We can work. We should be working. So when we get into heaven, we see this a little bit in here. Well, this is our main text. I just want to hit it first because some of you might read ahead and be like, what? Bodies? Huh? The bodies that we have here on earth are bodies that are decaying. They're decrepit. They will fail us. Eventually, our hearts will give out. Eventually, our knees will give out. Our fingers will hurt and ache as we get older. You know, as you get older, you don't get more purified in the body. That's not what happens. So our bodies here on earth, they just rot away. It wasn't supposed to be like that. When God created us perfect, he created the human body to be perfect. I mean, just look at it. Scientists are still trying to figure it out. They can't figure it out. They're just still looking at it and trying to understand it. He created it to be perfect. So Paul's talking a little about this, talking about when we get to heaven, we're not just going to be floating beings in heaven. We're going to have new bodies, pure, holy bodies. You know, I know for a lot of girls, you know, you see blemishes on your body, and you're just like, man, why do I have this? You know, I wish I didn't have this, or I didn't have that, or I wish this. Guys, we're the same way. You know, I wish I was just a little bit taller, a little bit wider, you know, shoulders a little bit bigger. You know? Listen, when we get to heaven, we're in perfect bodies. He's going to give us perfect bodies to worship him in. He's going to give us perfect bodies to, I'm sure, do tasks and duties in heaven. And I mean, God, this is what God's going to give us when we get to heaven, is perfect bodies. So you see that in the first part of this text, him talking about these perfect bodies. And, you know, it's just a crazy thing to see that. As a new believer, I'm thinking, whoa, new bodies? Man, this is awesome. You know, and that's really cool and really exciting. But as you keep reading on, you start in verse 11 and you start to see some even more exciting things you see in this. So Second Corinthians 2:5-17. Let's read that. Like I said, we're not going to read all the scripture. We're just going to pull out some verses in there because we don't have enough time to go through it all. 5:17 says, this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. The new life has begun. So listen. Salvation. Some of you accepted Christ this past weekend. Maybe it was this past year. Maybe some of you have rededicated your life. What does that mean? Well, first of all, it means that you are a new creation in Christ. You'll hear that terminology quite a bit. You are a new creation in Christ. See, before salvation, you have the tendency, the natural tendency to sin. The sin nature is a part of you. You can thank your father for that. That's passed down through him. You can go home and blame him for it. No, just kidding. Do that. Be like, Dad, it's all your fault. No, don't do that.
It's all your fault,
Dad. That's right. When we accept Christ, immediately we become a new creation. you have become a new creation. The old you is gone, and the new you has set up residence in you. Okay? It has set up residence in you. That sin, that nature of sinning and wanting to sin has been removed from you. And the new nature, the new you, the new God has set place and has set up tent in you. And what an amazing and beautiful thing we see that is. So what is salvation? What does it mean to be saved? It means that God comes in and creates anew. He creates you into a new creature, a new being. You don't get a new body. It's still the same body. You didn't wake up, you didn't fall asleep and be like cocooned in, and all of a sudden you wake back up and you're like, whoa, this is great. You know what I mean? Like, but what's affected is the inside. The outside is you. That's on your responsibility. The inside is on God's responsibility. And are we going to look old where? I have no idea. I think I'm looking like I'm like, you know, like good. 22, it'd be nice. You know. 21, you know? No. We look like who? I never want to look like Beyonce ever. So, especially in those weird pictures of her.
That's Rihanna.
Is that Rihanna?
No,
that was Beyonce. That's what I thought. Those are like devilish pictures. Anyways, listen, we are a new creation. Listen, when we accept salvation, when we are saved, we are a new creature. Romans 8, 9 through 11 says, but you are not controlled by your sinful nature. You are controlled by the Spirit if you have the Spirit of God living in you. Listen, if you've accepted Christ, you have the Spirit of God living in you. You are not controlled by your old sinful nature. It goes on and says, and remember that those who do not have the Spirit of Christ living in them do not belong to him at all. Verse 10 says, and Christ lives within you. So even though your body will die because of sin, God created us as humans to be pure and holy and last for eternity. But because of sin entering the world, our bodies now decay and we die. Even though your bodies will die because of sin, the Spirit gives you life because you have been made right with God. The Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead, check this out, lives in you. And just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he will give you life to your mortal bodies by the same Spirit living within you. You know what? Sometimes when we talk about our lives, when we talk about us before salvation, we are considered dead. We're considered dead. We're just like zombies roaming the earth. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Like, it's just dead.
Yes.
When Christ enters us, he gives us life. He says, yes. Christ gives us life. He gives us life. Listen, I can remember the months, the years directly after accepting Christ. I can remember those. It was just like, wow. Man, this is something crazy. I've never experienced anything like this before. And this is amazing. And you know what? As we read Scripture and we grow older in our faith, that experience tends to happen deeper and more often because we realize the power and the majesty of God. So first things first, we accept Christ, we become a new creation. My whole being, nature, life, behavior has changed because of the dwelling of the Holy Spirit within us. Secondly, I was dead in my trespasses, my sin, but now I've been made alive. And thirdly, I am now a child of the Almighty God. This is...
I can't take any requests right now. Please try again in a little while.
I don't have Siri.
Epic fail. We become a new creation. I'm now a child of the Almighty God. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. Listen, guys, once you become saved, you are now adopted into the family of God. What does that mean? That means that you are a part of his kingdom. That means you are a part of the heir. That means you are now royalty. I think I've talked about this before, many years ago, I think now. Listen, when you become a believer, you are now royalty. Start acting like it. Listen, the Bible tells us that God will never give us something we can't handle. Jesus came and conquered sin for us. We are conquerors because the Spirit lives in us. The same Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead. Listen to this. The same spirit that rose Jesus from the dead is the same spirit that is in you. You are a conqueror. You are royalty. You are a part of a family that is eternal, that will eternally love you, care for you, provide, be there for you. That's the family you are now a part of because you have accepted salvation. Secondly, I am reconciled to God through Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 5, 18 and 19 says, "And all of this is a gift from God, a gift from God, who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us this task of reconciling people to him." Verse 19, "For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sin against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation." What does the word reconcile mean? Anybody know?
To fix.
That's right. The definition on Google says to mend a friendship. So reconciliation means that at one time there was a relationship there, and that relationship has now been reconciled. It has been now repaired. It's now been fixed. It doesn't say that a new relationship has begun. No. It says that a relationship has been reconciled. It has been repaired. Because ultimately, in the beginning, we were created to have a relationship with God. And through Jesus Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, through salvation, we have been reconciled to God. Our friendship has been mended with him. So because of salvation, one, we become a part of the family. We are adopted and we are a new creation. Number two, we are reconciled. The friendship, the relationship between us and God has been mended. I have peace with God through the blood of Jesus Christ on the cross. Colossians 1, 19 and 20 says, For God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ, and through him God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by the means of Christ's blood on the cross. Why we need reconciliation? Because sin has ruined our relationship with God. Because sin, if we are naturally children of wrath, we are hostile with God. That's why we need reconciliation. Because of sin in our lives. Because of sin in our lives. And naturally, there's wrath there. And we need Christ to change that. And he does change that. All right, thirdly, of becoming a new believer. This is when it gets me the most excited. I am an ambassador of God. Colossians 5:20 says this. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead to come back to God. What is an ambassador? Does anyone have any idea what an ambassador is? Someone who makes peace? Okay, yeah.
One who represents something.
Go for it, Rick.
Really?
Go for it.
Someone that represents something.
He's someone that represents something or a country. So we have ambassadors. Check this out. We have ambassadors who go from the United States to different countries representing the United States. So that way we don't have to send the whole United States there to deal with a situation, okay, which would be insane, but it would be a fun trip. But it would be insane for all of us to go there. We as a country send somebody in our government as an ambassador to go over and represent us. As an ambassador, it is an authorized representation of a sovereign state, city, country. Listen, as believers in Christ, you have now become an ambassador of God. And you know what? That pumps me up. Salvation pumps me up. Becoming a part of God's kingdom and his family pumps me up. Being created new, the old is gone, the new has been placed, and that pumps me up. But you know what gets me more excited? Is the fact that I have the opportunity to be the representation of the King, the creator of this world. That is crazy. Me, you, we have the opportunity to share with this world, to be the ambassador to this world of God Almighty. That's insane. But you know what? That's the responsibility that we have. So just becoming saved, just accepting Christ, does not mean that you just get a free, go to heaven free card. Get out of jail free card. Thank you. That's what I'm looking for. It means that you now are an ambassador of God. You now have the opportunity, the power, the respect, the understanding, the sovereignty to go forward and to share that and to deal with this conquer this world and conquer it. Why? Because you are now you're an ambassador. You're an ambassador of God. Listen, an ambassador speaks on behalf of the ruler that he represents, the king he represents, the country, the government he represents. Listen, as believers, we have the opportunity to represent God on this earth. We should be pumped about that. That's a pretty big deal. That's way better than being a representative of this government, because everybody hates us anyways, but you know what I mean? It is so much better to be an ambassador of God. That's awesome. That's awesome. An ambassador's whole duty and responsibility is to interpret the ruler's mind faithfully to those who have sent him. And that's a big deal, because that requires this. That requires this. I guarantee you, when an ambassador goes to another country, and whatever they're dealing with at that moment in that country, he's going to have some type of book or something he's going to need to go through, some guide. And that's exactly what this is. This is our guide to being an ambassador to this fallen world. Listen, God has orchestrated, set up, organized, and planned the every move that needs to happen for all of his ambassadors. He's given us the guidebook, the rule book, the understanding book, the all-knowing, knowledgeable book. He's given it to us to be the best ambassadors that we possibly can in this world. And we should be proclaiming God's word. Ephesians 19 and 20 says, "And pray for me to God, asking God to give me the right words so that I can boldly explain God's mysterious plan, that the good news is for Jews and Gentiles alike. I am in chains now, still preaching the message as God's ambassador. So pray that I will keep on speaking boldly for him as I should." Listen, this guy is in chains. He's barred. He's still being an ambassador of God. He realized, he understood what being a believer, what having salvation meant. Being an ambassador of God means I do not speak in my own name, voice, or my own opinions. I speak on behalf of God, who I represent. My whole duty and responsibility is to interpret God's mind faithfully to those who I am sent to. You know what? That too, who I am sent to, could be your family. It could be your friends, your boyfriend, your girlfriend, your brother, your sister. What an amazing thing it is to be an ambassador of God. And lastly, I am redeemed through Christ. Salvation means that I am redeemed through Christ. My redemption was obtained for me at the cross. Hebrews 9:12. With his whole blood, with his own blood, not the blood of goats or calves, he entered the most high place once and for all time and served our redemption forever. Secured our redemption forever. My redemption was sent to me in the gospel. Psalms 111:9 says, "He has paid a full ransom for his people. He has guaranteed his covenant with them forever." What a holy and awe-inspiring name he has. Students, my question for you tonight is this: who do you live for? Who is it you're living for? Is it for the Almighty God? Is it for Jesus? Or are you still on that edge? Are you still kind of living for yourself? Are you still living for a boyfriend, a girlfriend? Are you still living for your grades? What is it you're living for? When we become a believer, we are a new creation in Christ. I have been reconciled. You have been reconciled to God through Jesus Christ. You are an ambassador to God. And you have been redeemed through Jesus on the cross. Listen, students, that's what salvation means. You are a new person who has the opportunity to be a part of a family that is eternal and loving. Because of Jesus, your friendship with the God, your God, your father has been fixed. You have now been elected an official of this kingdom to share his word. And it's all done because of Jesus. It was all done because of that guy who hung himself on the cross for you. I want to encourage you guys as we go on for the rest of this year. I want to really challenge you to stick strong in your faith. Now listen, you're going to have issues. You're going to run into bumps. There's going to be hardship. That's a part of life. You live in a world that is dying, decrepit, and rotting. But if you accepted Christ, if you've rededicated your life back to him, listen, you have something to live for. You have a responsibility. And on top of that, you have the talents God's blessed you with, the spiritual talents God has blessed you with. God created you for a purpose. And listen, if you're in this room, you have no idea who Jesus is, well, that's fine, because we can fix that. Because God has a plan for you. He has a plan for your life. He has some really amazing and great things that he wants for you, and he wants to see happen through you and because of you. So I encourage you, take that leap of faith. Take that jump. Take that, man, I don't really know if I want to do this, and do it. Make it happen. Make it happen. Listen, God came, he died, and he died for us. The man with the name was Jesus. That guy hung on a cross for you. That's crazy. Then he was killed because of me and my sins. Put in a tomb. Rose 3 days later by the same spirit that's in me now that has given me the ability and the opportunity to be a part of his family, have my friendship fixed with God, and now have the opportunity to share God with anybody and everybody and the authority to do that because I understood and I accepted that salvation. Let's pray. God, we love you. Father, we just thank you so much for this great day, God. Man, what an amazing thing it is to have accepted Christ. What a beautiful thing that is, God. You laid out for us what salvation is. It's being created new. It's being our friendship being mended. It's us being an ambassador of your kingdom, being an ambassador to the world to share your gospel with as many people as we can, and it's all because of Jesus. And Father, we just thank you so much for you sending that guy, Jesus, to come and die for us. Man, what an amazing thing that was. For him to die for me, and to die for each one of us in this room. Father, if there's a student in this room, or a parent, or a leader in this room that's never accepted you, God, I pray that our hearts would be burning and urging for that to happen, God. But Father, if we've rededicated our lives recently, if we've just recently accepted you as our Savior, I pray that you'll encourage those people. I pray that you'll strengthen them. Satan is angry and he's mad because of that. God, I pray that you allow them to chase after you and have the adrenaline and the ability to do that, God. Father, we love you. We thank you for this great day. Bless us and take care of us and bring us back next week, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.